Of chapter one. So before we start our discussion, I pay my humble obeisances to all the assembled devotees and I seek your blessings so that I can share something here today. And we will also recite the Mangala Charan prayers before we start, and I hope you can join me behind the muted mics. ॐ अज्ञानतिमिरान्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकया चक्षुरोन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरुवे नमः श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूप गदामयं ददाति स्वापदान्तिकं वन्देऽहं श्रीगुरो श्रीयुतपदकमलं श्रीगुरुं वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातं सहगणा रघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजना सहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधाकृष्णपादां सहगणा ललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितंश्च हे कृष्णा करुणा सिंधो दीनबंधो जगत्पते गोपेशा गोपिका कांत राधा कांत नमोस्तुते तप्त कांचन गौरांगी श्री राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्यैव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर शिवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्णा हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे नमो विष्णुपदाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते राधानाथ स्वामिनीति नामिने नमो विष्णुपदाय कृष्णपृष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामिनीति नामिने मुखं करोति वाचालं पंगुं लंघयते गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वंदे श्रीगुरुदीनतारणं परमानन्दमाधवं श्रीकृष्णचैतन्ययीश्वरं ओं तत्सत् हरे कृष्ण. So today's verse is 46 and it's the last verse of chapter 1. So we will conclude today. I will recite the verse and we will discuss with everyone's blessings. So this verse is spoken by Sanjaya. Sanjaya uvacha evam uktva junak sankhe rathopastha upavishat visrujya sa sharam chapam shoka samvigna manasaha. Translation and purport by Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Sanjaya said, Arjun, having thus spoken on the battlefield, cast aside his bow and arrows and sat down on the chariot, his mind overwhelmed with grief. And purport, while observing the situation of his enemy, Arjuna stood up on the chariot, but he was so afflicted with lamentation that he sat down again, setting aside his bow and arrows. Such a kind and soft-hearted person in the devotional service of the Lord is fit to receive self-knowledge. Thus end the Bhaktivedanta purports to the first chapter of the Srimad Bhagavad Gita in the matter of observing the armies on the battlefield of Kurukshetra. So in this verse, we can see the purport is really small and Srila Prabhupada is highlighting two main points here. The first thing is Srila Prabhupada says that Arjuna is so afflicted by lamentation that he sat down, setting aside his bow and arrow. And the word here, manasaha, which refers to the mind, is very prominent. And also the other important point in this verse is that such a kind and soft-hearted person in devotional service of the Lord is fit to receive self-knowledge. So basically Arjuna, he is a pure devotee of the Lord. And He knows everything. He has all the knowledge. He has the knowledge of the Shastras. He is very, very learned. But he is put in the illusion so that through him, we can get the knowledge of Bhagavad Gita. That is the plan of Lord Shri Krishna. So Arjuna is basically representing all of us. Arjuna is at the moment overtaken by grief. And all the reasons that we have heard and learned throughout the last so many wonderful sessions, that there were so many reasons Arjuna gives, right? And then at the end, he says that, that's it. I'm done with this and I've had enough and I've completely decided that I cannot fight. And he's lamenting. He's completely grief-stricken. So he is representing us. All of us also, we go through in life in some at some point of our life while doing our duty. We are also perplexed, sometimes overwhelmed by the pressure. Many situations in life comes like that. I can straight away think of one or two when I read this verse that all of us go through this. And I wanted to ask you all, if you can use your chat button or raise your hand by using reactions, and if you can interact and say that whether in your life you ever came across such a situation while doing your duty, there are so many factors and your mind, manasaha, right? The main word in this verse. So is your mind has taken you over by so many emotions and the pressures. You cannot think clearly. You cannot see the situation and you cannot take a proper decision at that time. So can you please use the chat button or raise your hand, or one or two of you can unmute and even mention if you feel like mentioning what was the situation. Or you can say yes or no. Did you ever have such a situation in life? Okay, let's see the chat. There is something in the chat. Oh, okay, there are messages. Yes, Namrata Mataji is saying many times, Mataji, Puja Mataji. Yes, Mataji. Okay, thank you for your inputs. Yes, we all do. Yes, Mataji. Yes, Mithaliji. Thank you. So we all do. And if we haven't, then the life seems to be very straightforward and very easy otherwise for all of us. But that does not happen so most of the times. So what happens here is that, let's see, first of all, because we just want to think what this verse is talking about, and we need to put ourselves in that situation and really feel what is Arjun going through right now. So if we meditate and think about the times in our life where we had such a situation, then it helps us to actually understand what is happening here on the battlefield. Yes, our situation might not be to this degree what Arjun is going through, but he's a pure devotee. So he's asking so many questions to Krishna in the following chapters. And right now he is completely perplexed. So for example, he has all the knowledge, but you know, when sometimes we see on television, if there is a person who's taking interview of a doctor, then he has to ask so many questions to that doctor, right? About so many diseases, so many things going around for the benefit of the listeners, for the audience. So when he's asking all these questions, it doesn't mean that the interviewer has all of those diseases. No, he's asking so that everyone in general can benefit from the information. Such is the case here. But at the same time, right now, Arjuna is put in this illusion and he's really, really overwhelmed. So this is what his mind has done to him. But originally, he's a pure devotee of Lord, full of knowledge. But this is what the mind does. When one starts relating oneself completely with the body and affected by the modes in this material nature, one cannot see things clearly. And here we can see that one moment, I need to move this so I can see the screen. Arjuna's saintliness is revealed by the following points. So here Srila Prabhupada has mentioned in the purport that such a person who is so soft-hearted, he is fit to get the spiritual knowledge. So how is Arjuna a soft-hearted person? We can see that he is prepared to forgive the Kauravas completely. There is no grudge in his heart. He is completely happy to forgive, not fight and let it go. So the person who is soft-hearted, in a hard-hearted person's heart, Krishna does not enter. So this is the first quality, that one should be soft-hearted. One should have compassion for everyone. But here the problem that has happened is that Arjuna's compassion is at the bodily level. It is a wrong compassion. And we will see in chapter 2 why. More and more we will learn about it, that in the science of soul, that how body and soul is different. So these are the reasons he has given why he is putting his bow and arrow down, that he is ready to forgive the aggressors. Also, he is conscious of the obligations to protect the family traditions and morals. He does not want the evil consequences, right? Because if he kills, then he will incur the sin. And he does not want to kill even for the exchange of three worlds. And all these reasons have been given by Arjuna, and he is even ready to be killed unarmed. Now, something like this for Kshatriya is completely does not suit a Kshatriya at all. These are not the characteristics of a Kshatriya. Just one moment. I'm trying to close the window here. Just give me one second so I can see the slide. Yes. So, ready to be killed unarmed, but not retaliate. Custom according to Kshatriya fighting principles, unarmed and unwilling foe should not be attacked. So, and then these symptoms are due to the soft-heartedness resulting from being a great devotee. Arjuna kept his bow down, even broke his vow of not keeping the bow once lifted. So, such a kind and soft-hearted person is fit to receive the self-knowledge. Now, here, quickly going through the verse, Arjuna has put aside his bow and his mind is filled with gloom, the shoka, and he's thinking, how can I fight? What can I do? And Arjuna, he is the foremost archer of his times. He's about to fight the most important war of his life. And this war was essential for establishing the dharma, the ethical order, for maintaining the society. Yet he is overwhelmed by emotion and is about to quit the war. So here Arjuna's consciousness is filled with lamentation. It is, and this lamentation has nearly paralyzed him and nearly sabotaging the biggest moment of his life. And, you know, we also get confused doing our duty. But here, fortunately, Arjuna had Lord Shri Krishna by his side to guide him in the context of his spiritual identity and ultimate purpose. So here, why Arjuna is becoming like this grief-stricken? Because he is deciding on the basis of his observation, on the basis of what he is observing. And so there are three things. One is observation is pratyaksha, anuman, and shabda. Pratyaksha is what we see in the matter around us. Anuman is something that happens with our own mind, with our limited knowledge. We cannot see beyond that. And shabda is the direct knowledge that comes from Krishna in the scriptures. So here, when we look up in the world and we try to do our own reasoning, we start getting doubts. Whereas if we follow the Shastras, the Shabda, the direct knowledge coming from Krishna, that nourishes our determination. And when we turn to Krishna, then we will come out of this dark gloom of ignorance in our life. And one more thing here is that our consciousness will be completely restored if we take the shelter of Krishna. So Arjuna is overwhelmed with grief and he is at the moment completely taken over by his mind. This has happened because he is connecting himself with the body and his attachments are with the body. So he cannot think beyond this at this point and he is completely overwhelmed. But the first thing for a spiritual life to start is we have to break this material connection of our mind, how our mind is connecting that I am this body. When we will come out of this concept, that's when the spiritual life starts. And that's why the first teaching of Bhagavad Gita chapter 2 talks about the difference between body and soul. Now here I wanted to mention there is it is very important here that how Arjuna has put aside his Gandiva, he has put aside his Gandiva bow. And there is a beautiful incident that will explain to us that how important this bow is to Arjuna and how it is so dear to him. So once what happened is that Arjuna had vowed to kill anyone who would suggest to him that he should put his bow down in the war. So once what happens that during this battlefield of Kurukshetra, Karna, he defeats and severely injures Yudhishthir, right? Yudhishthir is the elder brother of Arjuna, Pandavas. He is the eldest of Pandavas. So when Arjuna heard that Yudhishthir is injured, he immediately left the battlefield and went to the Yudhishthira's tent to see him. Now, Yudhishthir thought that Arjun is coming to see me, so he concluded that Arjun must have already killed Karna and come to see me. But when Arjun arrives, he says, no, I did not yet kill Karna. I have just come to check on you because you are hurt and you are injured, so I was concerned. And at this point, Yudhishthir becomes completely furious. As a Kshatriya, he calls Arjuna a coward and he says that you better give up your Gandiva bow. Your first duty would have been to kill Karna and then if you want to come and see me. But how can you just leave the battlefield like that and come and see me? So you are a coward and you should give up your Gandiva bow. At this point, Arjuna becomes so furious and he says that how can you say this? My Gandiva bow is more dear to me than my life. It's my vow to kill anyone who suggests that I put my Gandiva bow down. So this is how dear it is to Arjuna. And what Arjuna does is that he takes out his sword because he had taken a vow. Yudhishthir has told him to put the bow down. So now he has to kill him. But obviously Krishna comes to the rescue and he says that no. For a Kshatriya, if you just insult him, it will be as good as killing him. So then the incident goes that they Arjuna insults him a lot by saying that when Draupadi was insulted, how could he just have sat there watching the scene? He should have actually killed Karna then and there. And this is how the dialogue takes place. But and then they both really regret their words. And the next moment, Arjuna falls to the feet of Yudhishthira and begs forgiveness. And both the brothers understand that what happened, the incident was wrong, using the words and insults. But the main point we are learning from this incident is that Arjuna had not lightly made the Gandiva vow. Therefore, it is significant that Arjuna, the great son of Pandu and Indra himself, he cast aside his bow and sat down on the chariot. His mind was overwhelmed with grief. We can only imagine how disturbed Arjuna must have been about this disaster that was awaiting him and the entire world at this Kurukshetra. So we can see that something so important to him, he just put it down and he said, I will not fight. So here we can see that how Srila Prabhupada has also stressed and the main point manasaha. So the mind does this to us. When we don't have the will to do our duty, it is this sabotage, studying thoughts that they come to our mind. So when Arjuna had to lose the will to fight, actually, he had lost his willpower. That means that he had lost the fight. How can a Kshatriya lose the willpower? So if anyone had told, that's how. Here what happens is, even us, I wanted to look at it from the practical side, that even we are more vulnerable and we can also be misled from inside rather than by others outside. So here the battle is manasaha, the inside. Arjuna is getting the suggestions from his mind, from inside. And this is why he puts his bow down. Instead of getting infuriated, he becomes overwhelmed because his mind has given up at the moment, his willpower to fight. And this is the devastating and the deluding power of the mind. If we let the mind's negativity get to us, we can also lose the fight even before it begins. So situations like that can come in our life. And Bhagavad Gita's message will equip us internally in two ways. How? So the first way Bhagavad Gita can help us is with the knowledge of the existence of the inner enemy, the mind. Mind can be the friend or it can be the enemy. And secondly, with the weapon of spiritual knowledge, that we are part of the whole. We are part and parcel. We are not the whole. The entire whole is Krishna. We are just the part. And Krishna is spiritual and the soul is indestructible. And Krishna is fallible, infallible, sorry, and we are fallible. So when we know our position and our connection with Krishna, that knowledge will definitely help us to overcome the weakness of the mind. And we can do prayerful contemplation when we are in such a situation, that how best we can serve Krishna in that situation. And through that situation, thus mind's grip on us will loosen and we can find the will to continue the fight. So that's the message of Bhagavad Gita, and that's what it did for Arjuna, right? In 18.78, Arjuna is guided by Krishna's grace towards the inner clarity and outer victory. We know the verse goes, the last verse of Bhagavad Gita, Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna, Yatra Partha Dhanurdhara, Tatra Shri Vijayo Bhuti, Dhruvanitir Matir Mama. So wherever there is Lord Shri Krishna and wherever there is the expert archer, Arjuna. Here it is very important. We can see that Arjuna is mentioned here as archer. Wherever there is Arjuna, the supreme archer. So it starts with Arjuna putting his bow and arrow down, and it ends with mentioning the same archery skills of Arjuna. That wherever there is Krishna, master of all mystics, and wherever there is Arjuna, the supreme archer, there will also certainly be opulence, victory, extraordinary power and morality. That is my opinion. So I was just contemplating on the purports of Srila Prabhupada in connection to this verse, and there are so many connecting cross-reference that we can look here, is that if we look at, could not put all the verses on the slide, but if you have Bhagavad Gita with you, you can also open it. Right now I have opened verse 2.22. The verse 1.46 we are discussing. 4.1 I have put because 2 million years ago Bhagavad Gita was spoken. First from Lord Shri Krishna to Vivaswan, the sun god, then to Manu and then to Ikshvaku. So after those 2 million years, just 5,000 years ago, this knowledge is revived by Lord Shri Krishna speaking Bhagavad Gita to Arjuna. So that's how this knowledge is revived and here and learn from Srila Prabhupada's purports and Guru Vainacharya. So that is the significance of 4.1. And this argument of Arjuna is refuted by Lord Shri Krishna in 2.22. And there, this verse beautifully says that it's like two friendly birds sitting on a tree. We are like that, us, soul and the super soul within our heart. When we are the one who is enjoying, we are doing all the activities or whatever problems we are going through, and the other bird is watching us, which is the super soul. But Lord Shri Krishna, this is a friendly bird that is waiting for us to turn to him for guidance. He is our best well-wisher and he's waiting when will we turn to this other bird who is right next to us in our heart. And there is this beautiful purport by Srila Prabhupada, and I thought I'll read it. It clearly says that in some way or other, if he turns his face to his friend, the Lord, and knows his glories, at once the suffering bird becomes free from all anxieties. Arjuna has now turned his face towards his eternal friend Krishna and is understanding the Bhagavad Gita from him. And thus, hearing from Krishna, he can understand the supreme glories of the Lord and be free from lamentation. Arjuna is advised herewith by the Lord not to lament for the bodily change of his old grandfather and his teacher. He should rather be happy to kill their bodies in the righteous fight so that they may be cleansed at once of all reactions from various bodily activities. One who lays down his life on the sacrificial altar or in the proper battlefield is at once cleansed of bodily reactions and promoted to a higher status of life. So there was no cause for Arjuna's lamentation. Hence, this is completely explained very beautifully why Arjuna should not be lamenting and how his manasaha, his mind at the moment is not his friend, but is his enemy. And that's where we can read verse 6.6. And the verse is, it's a beautiful verse, Bandhuratma Manastasya yenatmaivatmana jitaha anatmanastu shatrutve vartitatmaiva shatruvat. For him who has conquered the mind is the best of friends. But for one who has failed to do so, his mind will remain the greatest enemy. That is why it is very, very important to control the mind. And again, here Arjuna says in 6.34 that chanchalam hi manah krishna pramathi balavad drudam. For the mind is restless, turbulent, obstinate and very strong, O Krishna. And to subdue it, I think, is more difficult than controlling the mind. Is that Arjuna takes shelter of Lord Shri Krishna, and the verse is 2.7 is, let me see, Karpanya dosho pahata svabhava pruchami tvam dharma samudha chetaha yashreya shanishchitam bruhitanme shishyas deham sadhi mam tvam prapannam. Because this mind is so difficult to control, Arjuna says, now I am confused about my duty and I have lost all composure because of miserly weakness. In this condition, I am asking you to tell me for certain what is best for me. Now I am your disciple and a soul surrendered unto you. Please instruct me. So here he becomes disciple from a friend. Arjuna becomes disciple and he's requesting Krishna to be his guru and to enlighten him. And that's when who is eligible to get this knowledge from Krishna? Who can get the spiritual knowledge? And that's what is beautifully explained in chapter number 13. From 8 to 11, chapter number 13, it talks about all the qualities and 20 elements for receiving the eligibility to receive the spiritual knowledge. So here, one of them is a person who is friendly to everyone, who is very humble, who can forgive everyone. That person, along with all those 20 qualities, here we can see Arjuna has all of this quality, and one of them is soft-heartedness, which is mentioned in this chapter. That all these qualities clearly show that Arjuna is eligible. And after hearing how Krishna will enlighten Arjuna, in 1873, Arjuna actually says, Karishye Vachanam Tava. So Arjuna said, my dear Krishna, O infallible one, my illusion is now gone. I have regained my memory by your mercy. I am now firm and free from doubt, and I am prepared to act according to your instructions. And here it is very important. It says, Karishye Vachanam Tava. I will do your will. I will act according to your instructions, Krishna. Here, Arjuna is not saying that I will fight. He says, I will act according to your will. So now Arjuna's vision has become much broader, much deeper. It is not just about fighting, but any duty, anything that Arjuna has to do, he will do as per the will of Krishna, because Krishna is our best well-wisher, and it is our dharma to follow the guidelines and the instructions that are in Bhagavad Gita. And this is the best thing that can happen to us if we can turn to Bhagavad Gita in any situation of life. It's a very universal, practical instructions for all of us in Bhagavad Gita that we can follow. And that is why discussing in Devotees Association and hearing it in a disciplic succession is extremely important. So that's what I wanted to mention, that how this step-by-step, it's a very systematic study. Bhagavad Gita is a very, very systematic study. And we can see that if we follow the Shabda, the Shastra, then even us, when we are overwhelmed, you know, it can happen, for example, if somebody who is playing sports, right? Nowadays, we can take example of sports. Say a sportsman, if he is in a cricketer, he's playing this big match, and if he puts his bat down and sits down on the ground, then what happens? This is not how a batsman will behave on the cricket ground. He has to play the match. He cannot put his bat down and sit down. What has happened here? He's completely taken over by his mind, who's right now become his enemy. The negativity of the mind is not allowing him to do his duty. And what is the way to control the mind? So that is performing bhakti yoga. We really need to keep Krishna in the center. And you know, all these activities that we do everyday basis following the sadhana, that is the reason why we do it, because by a regulated sadhana, following the four regulative principles, chanting, doing all of our worship and reading, discussing and hearing, all of this is extremely important, because when the tough time comes, that's when it will be very useful. If we have gained this knowledge and done the proper sadhana, we will be able to reflect on the problem in a better consciousness, in a Krishna consciousness way. And hopefully how Arjuna has come to this breakdown point will not happen with us. That point will not come, because Krishna will guide us from within and through the devotees around us. If we remain in good association, we will always be protected. So to overcome delusion and dejection, lamentation, grief, and the false compassion like Arjuna, you know, if you think about it, that if he had completely refused to fight and if he had actually not fought, then that action would have rendered all the archery skills and knowledge that he had, that he acquired lifelong, all of that would have become useless. So, for example, we can also take, I said, gave this example of a cricketer, but then there is also students. Say they are giving competitive exams or during their time of exam just before, they might also get overwhelmed with the pressure, and the certain thoughts might come to their mind. They are actually very able and really able, and they have all the abilities to perform well. But if their willpower is weak, then they cannot perform in the examination. So this applies to everyone. We need to keep very strong in our Krishna consciousness, in our principles, and believe in Krishna to do our duty to the best of our knowledge and leave the result to Krishna. If we take Krishna's shelter, you know, there is this also nice saying, dharma rakshita, the dharma rakshita, the one who takes shelter of dharma, dharma will protect them. So if you take shelter of dharma, you are going to be protected, you are bound to be protected. So yes, dharma rakshita rakshatanam. So that's why it is very important to be Krishna conscious. And here Srila Prabhupada says that about controlling the mind. Someone would like to read this? This paragraph, beautiful paragraph.
Yes.
Yeah. Who would like to read?
Hi, Mataji.
Yes, Hare Krishna. Please. Yeah, who is set first? I don't. Are there two persons? Yes, Jolly Mataji.
Well, let the other Mataji do it.
I cannot see my
okay,
on my.
Okay,
is that okay, Mataji?
Yeah.
It's time, Mataji. Do you do it?
Oh, thank you,
Mataji. Thank you. Dandos Pranam, Mataji.
Puja.
It's about controlling the mind. The mind is the original cause of material bondage. It is followed by many enemies, such as anger, pride, greed, lamentation, illusion, and fear. The best way to control the mind is to engage it always in Krishna consciousness. Sarve Mana Krishna Pradhar Vindayu. Srimad Bhagavatam 9.4.18. Since the followers of the mind bring about material bondage, we should be very careful not to trust the mind. Srimad Bhagavatam 5.6.5. Thank you. Such a wonderful.
Thank you so much. Yeah, thank you, Mataji. Yeah, so the best way to control the mind, Srila Prabhupada says, is to engage it always in Krishna consciousness. And then he's quoting all these beautiful verses. We will not go into that detail at the moment there, but it would be nice if you can read up 9.4.18.20. It describes the worship, devotional service of Ambarish Maharaj, how he worships the Lord with all his limbs of his body. And there is a beautiful verse also. Yeah, I was reading this yesterday, so I thought I'll share it with everyone. It would be nice to end on a very happy note because it's a very heavy verse. Arjuna has given up and he's put his bow and arrow down and he's not going to fight. And we are just going to stop at this point. But for our own reflection and learning from Srila Prabhupada, it's very beautiful. There is a beautiful chapters in Srimad Bhagavatam, third canto. And the 28th chapter, it is about Kapila Dev instructing his mother Devahuti on the devotional service, performing devotional service. And one of this is a very beautiful verse, but if you want to read up, you can start from there are dharana stages of Ashtanga Yogi, but that also applies to Bhakti Yogi. Because we can also do dharana, we may not sit down like a yogi, but what we can do is when we take darshan of the Lord, we can, when we meditate on the overall form of the Lord, when we go to temple, we stand in front of Radha Krishna, then that overall meditation on the form is called dharana stage. And those verses are verses 13 to 20 of chapter 28, canto 3. And from 21st verse, which is here on the screen, till the end of the chapter, those verses are dhyana stage, where there is intensified meditation by the devotee on the every limb of the Lord, each and every limb of the Lord. And here Lord's lotus feet, it acts as thunderbolt that destroys the darkness and sins in our heart. And right now, Arjuna is also overtaken by this darkness of ignorance. So in that respect, I put these words down, and I thought maybe we can also read the purport of Srila Prabhupada here. So I'll read the verse, and then one of you may want to read the translation, and then one of you can read purport. So Srimad Bhagavatam 328.21 Sanchintayet Bhagavata Sharanaravindam Vajrankushadvajasaruruhalanchanadhyam Uttunga rakta vilasannakha chakravala Jyotsna birahat mahadhrudayandhakaram. Yeah, that's and then there is translation. Who would like to read?
Can I read, Prabhuji, Mataji?
Yes, sure, Mitali Mataji, please.
Thank you. The devotee should first concentrate his mind on the Lord's lotus feet, which are adorned with the marks of a thunderbolt, a goat, a banner, and a lotus. The splendor of their beautiful ruby nails resembles the orb of the moon and dispels the thick gloom of one's heart. Beautiful. Thank you, Mataji.
Thank you, Mataji. And who would like to read the purport?
Can I try, Mataji?
Yes, please. Yeah.
From purport of Srila Prabhupada, a concrete description of the eternal form of the Lord is given here. The Lord's soul is depicted with distinctive lines resembling a thunderbolt, a flag, a lotus flower, and a goat. The luster of his toenails, which are brilliantly prominent, resembles the light of the moon. If a yogi looks upon the marks of the Lord's soul and on the blazing brilliance of his nails, then he can be freed from the darkness of ignorance in material existence. This liberation is not achieved by mental speculation, but by seeing the light emanating from the lustrous toenails of the Lord. In other words, one has to fix his mind first on the lotus feet of the Lord if he wants to be freed from the darkness of ignorance in material existence. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Thank you so much, Mataji. So, yes, this is a very beautiful verse, and it's, you know, reciting the verses is very, very good habit actually every day, because we cannot express our feelings in the way that we want to, but if we read up all these beautiful verses that are here from Kapila Dev, then that's the best way, because everything that we want to pray to Krishna and learn is all here in the verses. That's why reciting the verses is a very, very, very nice, important devotional activity that we can all do. And Srimad Bhagavatam, Bhagavad Gita, there are so many verses that we can recite daily. So that's what was there to discuss today. And yes, to summarize the verse, we know here what has happened is that Arjuna is afflicted by lamentation. He has sat down and he has put his bow and arrow down. He has taken the decision not to fight. And such a kind and soft-hearted person who has no grudge for anyone in his heart, he's ready to even forgive all the miscreants. So such a person in devotional service of the Lord is fit to receive self-knowledge. So that is the verse 46 about. And yes, we have about 6 minutes for any questions, realizations, comments.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Yes, Hare Krishna, Pujataji.
It's just something on the mind. I just thought as we were reading it, could it be that for the devotees where the mind has become their best friend, and for the non-devotees or those who are materialistics, most of the times, mind can be their enemy. So hence, they get engrossed in this material world and then get tied further and further.
Yes, that is a good realization, Puja Mataji. So, yes, I think this is not a question, right? It's your comment.
No, it's my comment. Yes, my realization, yes.
Yeah, that is a good realization, Puja Mataji, because if we look back with my limited knowledge, what I can reflect on is it's the modes that is affecting all of us, because we are in this material world, right? And we are bound by the modes. We have our soul is entrapped in this body. And hence, if we perform devotional service, if we try to become devotees, if we take devotee association, then what we are doing is we are trying to remain or be most of the times in mode of goodness, sattva. Right? And that's when they say Krishna Mati Raho, right? When someone wants to bless someone, that your consciousness may remain, you always remain Krishna conscious. So such a person, Krishna from within will guide, and from outside devotees association, we will get guidance. So there are a very, there are less chances to actually fall down. But as you said, if someone is completely materialistic and they may be innocent and they may be not so fortunate to have this devotee association, they don't have the knowledge, then if they are in the passion and ignorance, then there are more chances of making mistake, taking wrong decisions, because there is no guidance from the Shabda, the Shastra, scriptures, and Guru and Krishna. That is why we need Guru and we need Krishna and we need devotee association. So that's, I agree with your realization, Mataji. That's a good one.
Hare Krishna, thank you.
Hare Krishna, thank you, Mataji. Any other realization, or if you have any question on the verse?
Mataji, Hare Krishna.
Yeah,
sorry.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. This is obviously what I feel. I agree with Pooja, Mataji. But Mataji, I sometimes find it difficult to always be in that mode. And what I mean by that is, because we're all human beings, there are at times where things happen, and in not anger, but you feel like you feel a bit frustrated because you don't want to say anything. And if you don't say something, you're again frustrated because you think something is wrong is happening, which you don't really believe in. So It's maybe I'm trying to get there, but I can't always be in that mode of letting it go.
Yes.
And I understand by reading Bhagavad Gita that I will get there one day, but being in Krishna consciousness 24 hours a day, I am finding it difficult. I'm not going to lie.
Mataji, a very nice realization. Thank you for sharing, Namrataji. And I'm sure I'm also, I would also put my hand up. I'm like you as well. So we are all not perfect. And it's not good to blame ourselves also that, oh, I'm like this, or I've done this, or I've got angry. No, it is not good. What 24 hours to remain Krishna conscious or to remain in the mode of goodness is difficult for most of us. So because the modes change throughout the day, there is a mixture of modes. So that's why when we wake up in Brahma Murta before sunrise and we chant, that is the best Murta. Even if you want to say, learn certain verses, or say, if you want to speak about a certain verse or discuss with someone, that is the best time, because just half an hour at that time, whatever we learn, it is as good as spending few hours later on in the day. Why? Because as the day progresses, our modes change. It changes from passion to towards the evening and night to ignorance, because we get tired, the mind gets tired, and the modes, they work on us. So it is okay, Namrataji, if that is happening, but this is the beginning for all of us, and we are here, we are discussing, we are learning from Srila Prabhupada and Guru and Acharyas and all the senior devotees here. So we are learning. So it is a good beginning, and we should be happy about it. When we get angry, it is nice that the realization is already coming, right? That I got angry when the anger came.
Yeah.
So that is a good change, isn't it? I mean, there are times when if somebody gets angry but does not even have this realization that this is wrong, then how to start, how to make a progress? So to have this realization is very good. If we remain in devotees association, then the best, one day, slowly, the best will come out of us. They get the best out of us, the devotees. So it is nice to hear and chant and repetition. That's what Namrataji, hearing a lot, hearing really helps, the Shravanam, the lectures and reading also. Because if we are doing some activity, we can't read, but we can definitely hear. If we are driving or cooking, yes, or, you know, ironing or working, doing the chores, we can hear. And hearing from the Shastras, from these elevated devotees, can be very, very purifying. When we hear, it goes in the heart and then it brings the transformation. So repetition, even in chapter 2, Srila Prabhupada says when this section comes between the verses 11 and 30, there is quite a few repetition about the soul, the knowledge of soul. And Srila Prabhupada says this repetition is very important because certain basic fundamentals in life must be cleared. The doubts must go. And because of our human nature, we tend to forget. So it's very important to keep repeating, hearing all the time. And chanting will definitely cleanse our heart because the names of Krishna are non-different to Krishna.
Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Thank you so much. Any other comments or question or realization? Okay, fine. So tomorrow we have a wonderful session coming up by His Grace Divinam Prabhuji, and we all look forward to the quiz. There is also a quiz, and Prabhuji has mentioned to download the Kahoot app, and looking forward to that. So thank you so much, Srimad Bhagavad Gita Ki Jai. And thank you so much for your participation and inspiration and allowing me to share something mainly for my purification. So thank you very much. Vancha Kalpa Tarubhyascha Kripa Sindhu Bhevacha Patitanam Pavnebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Prabhupada Ki Jai Anant Koti Vaishnav.
Thank you, Mataji. Thank you, devotee. Hare Krishna, everybody.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Thank you for everything.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.